The Defence Force has begun contacting New Zealand soldiers on unpaid leave to remind them they're not allowed to fight in Ukraine. It comes after New Zealand soldier Dominic Abelin was killed while fighting there this week. Journalist Tom Mutch is in the Donbass region of Ukraine, and I started by asking him how common it is to come across fellow New Zealanders in Ukraine right now.
I mean, it's not the most common thing in the world. I think the New Zealand government estimated that there were about 15 to 20 who stayed after the Russians invaded in February. However, there are a few trickling back in. Most are here, either they were former expats who've returned. There are a couple I know who are of Ukrainian origin but lived in New Zealand who've come back to help out and support with whatever skills they can. And yes, there are a number believed to be, you know, between about a dozen and 20 who are fighting in, you know, in the International Legion or in various regiments of the Ukrainian army. And of course, a handful of journalists have been in and out. I've been here for most of the time, but there's been a few other correspondents here who cycled in and out as well.
Dominic Abelin was fighting whilst on unpaid leave from his role in the New Zealand Defence Force. Among the international people who are fighting against the Russian forces, how common is it that they are actually members of their own nation's armies?
So almost to be actually, you can't just rock up and you know, get a place in the International Legion. There have been quite a large number of people who've been turned away. You are expected to have previous military experience, definitely preferably previous combat experience. And so it's very common to find people. It's probably more likely to find people who have retired from their own militaries, but it's definitely not unheard of. However, as you've mentioned to me, there are a number of militaries that do have a blanket ban on their troops serving in Ukraine. It's unclear to what extent those bans would be enforced when those service people returned home.
Yeah, I mean, aside from the significant personal tragedy, it is interesting to consider the geopolitical ramifications here. Would Russia see a distinction between a New Zealand soldier who has chosen to go to Ukraine on unpaid leave and join a foreign legion, and a New Zealand soldier who serves in our military?
Look, so I very much doubt the Russians would make a major distinction. What they do with foreign legion soldiers is they usually portray them as foreign mercenaries who are not legitimate combatants. In their eyes, that means that they are allowed to not treat them as prisoners of war under the Geneva Conventions. That's what we've seen that they've done with a number of the British soldiers who were Mariupol defenders who were captured at the very end of that siege. Basically, the Russians will just take it as whatever suits their propaganda purposes the best. And it sometimes suits their propaganda purposes to have this idea that the whole world is against them. And so they will use whichever one suits them.
Yeah, so in a worst-case scenario, if there are New Zealand soldiers who have taken leave and choose to continue fighting in Ukraine despite requests from the New Zealand Defence Force, if they were to be captured by Russian forces, we have the potential for a really serious geopolitical situation.
Well, the difficulty is that the Russians would not officially say that they've captured them. They're likely to hand them over to their proxies in the Donetsk and Luhansk People's Republics. And the attempt that will be to try and get the New Zealand government to negotiate with those republics, thereby giving them some form of international legitimacy. So that's where a lot of thorny issues are coming into, particularly with the examples of the British soldiers that I mentioned before.
And Tom, you're in the Donbass at the moment. From the experience you have on the ground, why are these international soldiers joining the fight?
So I spoke to one volunteer just before I got on the phone with you, and there's a wide variety of reasons, but the most common one that I have heard is that people say that they see what's going on and they think it's horrific and that they have the skills to help and defend this sort of very kind of proud nation in the best way they can. And for many people, particularly military or ex-military, they see this as the most important fight of the century and that they want to be there for it to support in whatever way they can.